हेलो गाइस, आई होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग गुड। आई एम वैशाली किकान एंड वी आर डिस्कसिंग द VLSI टेक्नोलॉजी। इन दैट वी आर डिस्कसिंग द आयन इम्प्लांटेशन। टुडे दिस इज़ अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग वीडियो एंड इन द आयन इम्प्लांटेशन वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट अ लॉट ऑफ इम्पॉर्टेंट पैरामीटर्स लाइक द चैनलिंग, द डैमेज एंड द अनीलिंग। ओके, सो आई हैव ऑलरेडी इंट्रोड्यूस्ड चैनलिंग इन द प्रीवियस वीडियो एंड इफ़ यू हैव स्टिल नॉट वॉच्ड बोथ ऑफ द वीडियोज रिलेटेड टू द आयन इम्प्लांटेशन, इट इज़ हाईली रिकमेंडेड दैट यू गो एंड वॉच दैम ऑल्सो, सो दैट एट लीस्ट यू नो वॉट इज आयन इम्प्लांटेशन प्रोसेस। ओके, सो नाउ कमिंग टू द चैनलिंग, आई हैव ऑलरेडी टोल्ड यू अबाउट टू टाइप्स ऑफ स्टॉपिंग मैकेनिज्म। फर्स्ट इज न्यूक्लियर स्टॉपिंग, देन वी हैव द इलेक्ट्रॉनिक स्टॉपिंग। ओके, सो इफ the electronic stopping is predominant, if there is no nuclear stopping, then what would happen? I have already told in the previous video that the ion can penetrate deep inside the substrate and it can move at the very great depth inside the wafer where we don't want this ion to be present, and this is the channeling effect. Okay, so if the incident angle is right, ion can travel a longer distance without collision with the nucleus, and as we know there is no significant scattering in the electronic stopping mechanism, the ion can travel around a straight line path if it is encountering only the electronic stopping. Okay, so it has to collide with the nucleus of the lattice atoms in order to get a significant scattering. Okay, so now here you can see two types of ion collision. So this is the first incident angle for the ion collision and this is the second incident angle for the ion. So if the ion is coming from this direction, there will be a lot of collisions with the nucleus. Okay, but if the ion is coming from this direction, you can see here there will be no significant nuclear stopping and only the electronic stopping will be there, and due to which we have very few collisions in this case. Whereas if this case is considered, in this case we have a lot of collision. So in this case we have uncontrolled dopant profile because the dopant atom is reaching very significantly inside the wafer surface. Okay, so I hope now you understood what is channeling effect. So you can see this is the channeling ion which can reach very deep inside the substrate, and these are all the lattice atoms. Okay, so now if I have the collisional ions can go inside, but here it is colliding with the lattice atom and it will be having significant scattering. So what I have to do, I have to understand in which direction channeling will happen and I have to avoid the ion implantation in the same direction to avoid the channeling effect. So you can see what happens if I have the perfect direction where the channeling is not happening, but in some another special cases the channeling is happening after the collisions. So you can see we have the ions are moving inside, they are colliding with various lattice atoms. Okay, so now after various collisions the ions got a particular direction in which there is no lattice collision. So ion again is moving in a greater depth inside the wafer surface. But why? But here you can see the direction was not according to the channeling effect. So this is called the post-collisional channeling because this channeling occur after the collisional phase. We have various collisions over here and after all of the collisions we have the channeling that is taking place, and after again we have the collisional phase where the ion is stopping. So you can see over here, if I compute the distance from the surface and the dopant concentration, So the dopant concentration will be very high in the collisional phase because most of the ions are stopping, the dopant ions I am talking about, the dopant ions are stopping in the collisional phase only. Okay, so here only the dopant ions are stopping and we will be having a higher concentration in the collisional surface. Okay, then comes the channeling surface. You can see in the channeling surface, the ion concentration is decreasing. Why? Because ions are not stopping here. Ions are getting a path to move from the channeling area and these are again reaching to the collisional surface where they will be having a very high concentration. Okay, so now here and here we have the peaks and then we have two dopant region. So the one dopant region that I want, but actually I am getting two doped region. First is very near to the surface and the second doped region is very inside the substrate and this is occurring due to the channeling effect. So now coming to the ways to avoid this effect, how I can avoid this channeling effect, because this effect is very predominant if I don't consider the incident angle. So I have to first consider the incident angle. I can tilt the wafer 7 degree, which is the most commonly used channeling avoidance technique. I can use the screen oxides. If I am using the screen oxide, the amount of collision will be increasing and due to which channeling effect will be decreasing. I can use the pre-amorphous ion implantation. I can use the germanium surface. Okay, so this pre-amorphous implantation will be getting a lot of lesser channeling effect than the normal implantation. So now coming towards the shadowing effect. What is shadowing effect? As I have already told you that ions are in very high energy. They are at very high energy. They are coming to the substrate and they are hitting the substrate. And in the photolithography process, I have told you that we are making the mask. For the iron implantation process, we don't require the silicon dioxide mask. We can only use the photoresist mask. Okay, so now we have the photoresist mask and we have various patterns formed due to this photoresist mask. So now what we are doing, we are putting the iron beam and where the mask is not present, there it will be having the doped region and this is how the ion implantation process is taking place. But due to this mask, the photoresist layer that we have, due to this layer also we can have the shadowing effect. This layer can shadow some part of the open region also. Okay, so we have some exposed silicon surface where we want the doped region beneath it, but there could be a possibility that there would be some shadows formed. I will be showing this with the help of a figure. So what happens, we have the shadows formed if I change the angle also. So what I told you, in the channeling effect I am changing the incident angle, but when I change the incident angle, then shadowing effect will be predominating, that I have to avoid. So I can rotate the wafer and then I can use the post implantation diffusion also. Okay, so all of these processes are the ways to avoid the channeling effect. You can see how we have the shadowing effect. You can see here we have the polysilicon layer, or we can have the photoresist layer also. The ion beam is coming and hitting the surface, and when it is hitting the surface from the angle, okay, so the 7 degree angle that I have told you, if it is hitting at the 7 degree angle, this is the shadowed region that we have formed. So the doped region will be looking like this. We don't have the full doped region and this part will be forming. Okay, so this part will be forming the shadowed region. So this is after annealing and the diffusion process. We can increase the depth and here you can see we have the shadowed region. After annealing and diffusion, you can see the doped region has increased, but again it is not having a perfect anisotropic profile. So these are all of the limitations associated with the ways to remove the channeling effect. Okay, so now the question is, why don't people use the channeling effect to create deep junctions without high ion energy? Okay, why don't we use channeling effect for our own benefit? Why don't? Okay, so if I talk about the iron beam is not perfectly parallel. So if the iron beam is not perfectly parallel, many ions will start to have a lot of nuclear collisions. So when we have a lot of nuclear collisions, channeling effect will not be there. Okay, so there will be a lot of nuclear collisions with the lattice atoms after the ions are penetrating inside the substrate because the ion beam is not perfectly parallel. So some ion can channel deep into the substrate, but we cannot use it as a proper technique to incorporate doped region at a deeper depth. Okay, so some ions can channel deep into the substrate while many ions are stopped as the normal Gaussian distribution, due to which the ions are not moving very deep inside the substrate. Now coming towards the damaging effect. So what happens if I have high energy ions? The high energy ions are hitting the wafer substrate, and this is how they are penetrating inside. So if I have these high energy ions, hitting will be there. Due to hitting, there will be various damages produced on the wafer surface. Why? Because high energy ions will be containing a lot of energy. When a lot of energy is hitting the wafer surface, some bonds may be breaking inside at the wafer surface. And what I had the single crystal silicon wafer. So this single crystal silicon wafer will be having the damaged surface. So now on the surface, we don't have the single crystal structure for the silicon. On the surface, we have the polysilicon kind of, or the in some rare cases, we have the amorphous kind of silicon surface also. So now we have to use some mechanism to remove this damage also. So first we are talking about this damage. In the severe cases, the damage will penetrate into the depth of the silicon also, and in full of the wafer we have the damage. Okay, so if the ion implantation process is carried for long, or if the ion implantation process is done with high ion energy and with high atomic particles, so in that case the damage will be significant. So the implanted ions transfer energy to the lattice atoms, and this causes atoms on the surface to break, and the freed atoms will again collide with other lattice atom, and this is how this energy keeps on transferring from the surface atoms to the in-depth atoms also. So if ions are hitting, this hitting process produces some damage into the surface atom, the bond will break, and if the bond is breaking, this is again a free atom, this free atom will again hit inside atom, and this is how the process keeps on repeating, and we will be having more damage, more free lattice atoms. The damage continues until all free atoms stops. Okay, so one energetic ion can cause thousands of displacement, because if I have one ion, so one ion will be displacing inside many ions that it is hitting. Okay, so it can cause many, or it can cause thousands of displacements of the lattice ions. So you can see, if I have the light ion, in the case of light ions, the damage is very less as I compare the width. Okay, so if I compare the damage in across the surface depth, so the ions are moving very deep inside the substrate, and this is how it is causing a damage till a very deep point inside the substrate for the light ions, because the light ions are moving very deep. It is not having high energy that it will be displacing a lot of nearby atoms. In case of heavy atoms are not able to penetrate very deep inside, but it is actually moving a lot of nearby atoms. So the radius is very high. The damaged region will be having a high radius near the surface, but it is not having very high depth inside the crystal surface. So now coming to the damage process, you can see if the damage is done in the full wafer, you can see in before implantation we have the single crystal silicon wafer, but after implantation we have the amorphous kind of silicon wafer. This is a very severe damage that we have encountered. So the ion collide with the lattice atom and obviously they will knock them out of the lattice grid, and the implantation area on the substrate will become amorphous structure in the severe cases. So now coming to the annealing process. Annealing process is the recovery process. Now we have the damaged surface. Now we want to recover the actual surface from the damaged surface. So what happens? We are using the high temperature as the annealing process. Okay, the high temperature is around 600 to the 1100 degrees Celsius. So the dopant atom must be in the single crystal structure, and it should bond with the four silicon atoms to be activated as donor N-type or acceptor P-type. But if I have the amorphous structure, this possibility is very less. So I want the single crystal silicon structure. So the thermal energy from high temperature helps amorphous atoms to recover, and they will again become the single crystal structure. So how you can see, if this is the amorphous structure, these black atoms represents the dopant atom. So let's suppose we have boron penetrated inside this silicon crystal. So all of the white circles are the silicon atoms, lattice atoms. These black circles are the boron atoms. You can see they are in amorphous structure because all of them has the random structure. So now what we are going to do, we are supplying the heat from beneath. Okay, so we are supplying heat here. You can see if I am supplying heat, the first layer has become uniform again. It has become single crystal again. So again and again, if I am supplying heat for a longer duration of time, the second layer is also becoming single crystal. The third layer, fourth layer, fifth layer, as I keep on supplying the heat, the full structure will be becoming the single crystal structure. So you can see before annealing we had the amorphous structure, but after annealing we have the single crystal structure. And annealing is a very simple process of supplying heat to the wafer. So I hope now you understood what is annealing. Now coming to the rapid thermal annealing. So if I increase the temperature much, annealing outpaces diffusion. The diffusion process will be more and the annealing will be less. So the rapid thermal process is a widely used process for post implantation annealing, and it is a faster, better, and it will be giving me wafer to wafer uniformity, which is better than the normal annealing. It will be giving me the better thermal budget control, and it will be minimizing the dopant diffusion. So what happens in the rapid thermal annealing? We are fluctuating the temperature much, because if I keep on increasing the higher and higher temperature, then in that scenario the diffusion process will be more, and for that we are keep on fluctuating the temperature, and due to this we are getting rapid thermal annealing, and we are getting faster, better uniformity and better thermal budget also, because we are not constant at a high temperature, we are decreasing the temperature also, due to which the thermal budget will be high. Also the dopant diffusion will be minimized. You can see the RTP and the furnace annealing. In the RTP annealing you can see there is no diffusion. Okay, so diffusion is not predominant, and due to which I have the perfect doped region. That is what I want. For that only I did the ion implantation. I don't want to degrade this structure. And after the furnace annealing, in the furnace annealing, if I am supplying a high heat, the diffusion process will be there, and this doped profile region will be having the lateral effect also. It will be moving in the lateral direction as well. So this is the furnace annealing. So now coming to the question, that why can't the furnace temperature be ramped up and cool down as quickly as RTP system? Okay, I have already told you the advantages of RTP system. So why can't we do the RTP? Okay, so in the furnace, so the furnace is having the very large thermal capacity, and due to which it requires very high heating power to ramp up the temperature rapidly. It is very difficult to very highly ramp the temperature. So if I have a very high temperature, then only the furnace will be heating, and it is very difficult to fluctuate the temperature to very high value and very less value. at a very instant off time. So it is very difficult to ramp the temperature very high and very less without large temperature oscillations due to the temperature undershoot and the overshoot. And this is the reason we cannot use the furnace for RTP. So these are the references. I hope you understood each and every topic that I have discussed. If you still have any kind of doubt, feel free to contact me or you can refer these books. These are amazing books. And I will be trying to resolve your doubt as soon as possible if you are posting it in comment. I hope you like this video. If you like this video, please push the like button, subscribe to the channel and also do share it with your friends. Thank you so much.